the one more hernia in inguinal region, which is inguinal hernia, very important from the point of surgeon surgery and also from the point of anatomy. If you doesn't have the anatomical knowledge, it will be difficult to do the surgery in this region. First, let us see what is inguinal canal. This is the formation of inguinal canal. I told you earlier, this is because of the descent of testes. The canal is being formed from the posterior abdominal wall towards the anti-abdominal wall. And this is the canal, that is between the deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring. Deep inguinal ring is a gap in the tarsus. This is called fascia transversalis. The gap is created through which the guberniculum testis enters and coming out to occupy the space in the scrotal sac. That is called the superficial inguinal ring. That is formed by the two cura of the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle, superior and inferior cura. So this is by the opening in the external oblique aponeurosis. This is opening in the fascia transversalis. This is called deep inguinal ring. This is called superficial inguinal ring. So the canal is of a length of 4 cm extending from deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring. This is entry point, this is exit point. It is bounded by anterior wall, posterior wall, roof and floor. It is like a tunnel, okay. So what are the muscles that, what are the structure that is from the anterior wall? First the skin, superficial fascia, that is fascia corpora, fascia camper, external oblique aponeurosis and the muscular part of the internal oblique. That's forming the anterior wall of the inguinal canal, okay. Now the posterior wall. Posterior wall is formed by the fascia transversalis and a part of the conjoint tendon formed by the arched fiber of transversus abdominis and the internal oblique, that is from the conjoint tendon, and a part of the reflected part of the inguinal ligament. So that is the formation of the posterior wall. Anterior wall, skin, the external oblique and the internal oblique muscular part, posteriorly fascia transversalis, conjoint tendon and reflected part of the inguinal ligament. Okay, this is a boundary of the inguinal canal, and this is being extended. The first processus vaginalis is there, through which the testis will come to its own destination, that is called your the scrotal sac. And in between the skin there is an ectodermal muscle which is called the dartos muscle, that is formed by the membranous layer of the superficial fascia. Now this external oblique aponeurosis, that is from the external sphramatic fascia, chymesteric fascia, and then comes the fascia transversalis which is forming the internal sphramatic fascia as a covering of this scrotum. Okay. Now the roof and the floor of the inguinal canal. Roof is formed by the arched fiber of internal oblique and transverse abdominis, and the floor is formed by the grooved inguinal ligament and a part of the lacunar ligament. So this is the part, this is the roof, this is the floor. So there is a entry point, there is an exit point, there is anterior wall, there is posterior wall, there is a roof and there is a floor. Okay, roof is arched fiber and floor is grooved fiber of the inguinal ligament. This is the canal. Okay, the direction of canal is oblique, that is medially and forward. So it is obliquity of the canal which gives the protection of the intestinal loop to enter. That's called shutter mechanism. So there is a mechanism to resist the entry of the intestine in the increased intra-abdominal pressure called the defense mechanism of the inguinal ligament. So what are they? First is the obliquity of the canal. Okay, so the obliquity will resist the intestinal loop to enter to the deep inguinal ring. When there is a contraction, so the muscular fiber of the internal oblique, that will be compressed against the posterior wall, so the deep inguinal ring is closed. Okay, the superficial inguinal ring is closed by the contraction of the two curas. So superficial inguinal is sealed valve mechanism, it is closed, so no entry of the intestinal loop. And the chymester muscle reflected and it is pulled the testes, which acts as a ball valve mechanism. So there are flap valve mechanism, that is the obliquity of the canal, sealed valve mechanism, that is by the superficial inguinal ring contraction, and ball valve mechanism, that is by the pulling up the testes by the chymester muscle. Now there are two more mechanisms. One is a roof. Roof is formed by the arched fiber. So when the contraction is, it becomes flat. So the distance between the roof and the floor is short. So that is one mechanism by which the protection is given for non-entry of the intestinal loop for the hernia formation. And one more is the hormonal factors which help with the non-formation of the inguinal hernia. But still, The defense mechanisms are there, but sometimes the hernia can occur in case of old people. This type of hernia is present. Now, what is hernia? Hernia means the entry of normal or abnormal content through normal or abnormal opening. Normal content through normal opening is a normal phenomenon. Like deep inguinal ring for the passage of spermatic cord, that is a normal phenomenon. But if the intestinal loop enters through the deep inguinal ring, this is an hernia. This is indirect hernia or oblique hernia. Okay? This can be also present as a congenital hernia, we have already discussed. That is, processes vaginally persist and intestinal loop enters. This is the indirect hernia. So this hernia is occurring through the deep inguinal ring. Deep inguinal ring becomes larger in size because of the increased intra-abdominal pressures in sneezing, coughing, or constipated persons. So the loop will enter through it. So what are the coverings? It is the skin, the superficial muscle, the external spermatic fascia, internal spermatic fascia, kinesteric fascia. These are the normal coverings of the indirect hernia or oblique hernia. Okay. Now in case of direct hernia, see, intestinal loop can enter into the inguinal canal by two weak points. One is deep inguinal ring, that is indirect hernia, and one is through the posterior wall. Okay. So the posterior wall is formed by the fascia transversalis, half. Medial half is also strengthened by the conjoint tendon, and half of it is also contained by the reflected part of inguinal ligament. So these are the protection given by the posterior wall. Now if you think of this phenomena, that one goat or cow is coming and pushing the fence of your garden, it gives way. So that is how the herniated loop will enter through the posterior wall to become a direct type of hernia. Now posterior wall, what is the part through which the herniated loop enters? This is called Hasselbalch triangle, which is bounded by medially by the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscles, medially by the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscles, lateral by the inferior epigastric artery. Base is formed by the inguinal ligament. It is divided into the two parts, lateral part and the medial part, by the obliterated umbilical artery. Okay, so through the Hasselbalch triangle on the posterior wall, intestinal loops gives way, enter into the canal, forming the direct type of hernia. If it is passes through the lateral part, that is called lateral direct. How this happens? This is a deep inguinal ring, but it is occurring. You see, this is an inferior epigastric artery. So medial to the inferior epigastric artery, the herniated loop will enter. So it will be bounded by the external spermatic fascia, kinesteric fascia, and the fascia transversalis will be there. That is the point of basic difference between the indirect hernia and direct hernia. The direct hernia is having the fascia transversalis that is covering. Why indirect hernia doesn't have? Because the herniated loop enters to the deep inguinal ring, that is a gap in the fascia transversalis. So it is bounded by skin, kinesteric fascia, then the fascia transversalis, parietal peritoneum, and the intestinal loop enters. So this is how the lateral direct hernia coverings entry through the inguinal ligament from the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. Now in case of medial direct hernia, what are the coverings? You see, it is a conjoint ligament and the reflected part of inguinal ligament lies anterior to the wall. So the loop will enter and through it, so having this direct medial, all the coverings, fascia, along with that, the conjoint tendon and reflected part of inguinal ligament. So it is the skin, superficial fascia, then the reflected part of inguinal ligament, conjoint tendon, fascia transversalis, parietal peritoneum, these are forming the loop, and the entry of the medial direct hernia occurs. So these points you have to remember for the formation of inguinal hernia. This is the inguinal canal, how it is formed, what are the boundaries, that is the entry point, exit point, anterior wall, posterior wall, roof and the floor. Then you have to know about the indirect hernia. Then have to specifically know the posterior wall, how it is formed. What is the triangle on the posterior wall that gives way to the formation of hernia, Hasselbalch triangle? Then how? What are the coverings of the direct lateral hernia and direct medial hernia? Okay, this is all about your inguinal hernia. Okay.